just me and you. Head on down to the fishing hole. Grab your hat, get your pole. Let's go fishing when you're in the mood.
Canadian Sport Fishing has been brought to you in part by Rapala, premium fishing gear crafted from experience. Yamaha, conquer outdoors. Dickies, quality workwear since 1922. Northeastern Ontario, undeniably big, unbelievably close.
Most anglers have favorite fishing spots they like to head out to and specific lures and techniques that they like to use. Some like to troll and look for randomly feeding fish. Others like to zone in on small spots where they've caught fish in the past. One of my favorite types of fishing and techniques to use is actually to find large areas of shallow water, whether it's close to shore or off the shorelines, that are often missed by other fishermen. The only thing is that to fish those areas efficiently, you need to have good surface conditions. You know, it's so nice to get these fish in really shallow water. You know, one of my strategies when I'm fishing shallow water, especially close to shore early in the morning, is to use a very shallow running lure. You can see this looks like a shad because when I came onto the shoreline, I could see the shad in about 8 to 10 feet of water. This is a thin fin, and you can see why. Look at how thin this thing is. So it's actually just like a shad body. Now that's not a big smallmouth to start off with, but you know what? It was nice just to get the hit. So I'm gonna call today's episode called Smash Fishing, because when these fish hit these shallow running lures, they just come up and nail them. So you get them back. Oh, didn't take too long. Now, because this lure is so light, you can see that I filled up my reel really high. This is 20-pound test Suffix braid. And even though it's 20-pound braid, it's got the line diameter of 6-pound monofilament. The reason I've got it filled so much is so I can get good castability, because this lure is really light. So I try to cast so that the lure doesn't tumble when it goes through the air. And then I just retrieve it slowly and twitch it. What I'm trying to do is mimic those shad that are in this system. Finding fish over a large area, even in shallow water, can be really challenging because the key is to find something that looks a little bit different. This is where having a reliable fish finder is really important. Number one, to use the charts to locate those shallow flats and shallow areas close to shore. The other, to use the fish finder, and I love to use it in the down vision mode, to actually look for little irregularities that are along the bottom. It could be piles of rocks, it could be a point that extends out into 6-7 feet of water, it could be random weeds that are growing, just a little clump that comes off the bottom. Those are all key areas that really won't be shown on your chart, but you can find it with your fish finder. One feature that I really rely on, that I love with this Raymarine unit, is the side vision. It's one of the features. Now, what we're looking here on the screen, it looks a little bit different than when you have it in the fish finder mode or the down vision. We're actually shooting 150 feet to the left side of the boat. So you can see that all this dark area here, this is rock structure. And you wouldn't know it unless you went right over it with your motor. So I can actually find that structure and I can mark it by touching it with my hand or my finger, and I've got the waypoint there. Then I can go over to it and fish it effectively. If I go to the menu settings and I go into view, you'll see that I can set it so I can see both the right and left-hand side of the boat, or I can just look at the right, but in my case, I'm interested in the left because I know that's where probably most of the structure is. So this is one of the features that is indispensable, especially if you're fishing in big waters where everything is the same. If you find a rock pile or a little bit of a submerged reef that even comes up a couple of feet off the bottom, there's going to be fish there. And this year, because the weather has been so cool and the water temperature so cold, those areas warm up quicker and they're magnets for smallmouth bass and especially for pike. You know, this early morning shad pattern is working really well. I'm doing more retrieving than twitching it. And as the day progresses, I'm actually gonna go to a slash bait or a twitch bait. These guys are on the prowl and taking advantage of these shad that are going into very shallow water. So this is why this lure that looks just like it, you know, a lot of guys will troll with this particular lure. It works great for walleye, pike, and other species, but I love to cast it in that water less than 4 feet deep for these smallmouth bass. Now take a look at the dragonfly. See what I'm talking about here? I'm in 6 feet of water. You can see the depth right here. The water temperature is 64 degrees. See this clump of weeds that's up? I can't see them even though I've got really good sunglasses on, but if it's a little clump of weed like that, that's usually what the bass will go around. It's not so much because the food is in the weeds, they're just used to going to thing features that are on the bottom. And they kind of sneak up along those rocks and weeds, and if they see something flashing going by, they just lash out and hit it.
Closed captioning is brought to you by MD Marine Insurance. Boat insurance made easy.
When I'm fishing these shallow water areas and I'm using a lot of the lightweight lures, whether they're hard baits or soft plastics, I normally go with a spinning outfit and a lighter braided line, no heavier than 20-pound test, which is the line diameter of 6-pound monofilament. I want to make sure that my spools are full of line so I get maximum castability, and I use a spinning outfit that's kind of soft, not too stiff, because I want a little bit of lag time. When that fish comes up on the surface, a lot of time my instincts are to set the hook when I see the hit. So what I want to do is actually feel the fish on, then I know it's going to be hooked well. That guy hit close to the boat. Beautiful smallmouth. This guy's a little bit chunkier, so I've got to be careful because they've got so much energy. You know, a lot of times I'll hold him on the surface just so the nice, try the jump again. Which I don't mind being knelt down because it's a little bit easier to grab the fish. In a bass boat, you know, you're up off the water. There's a nice smallmouth. Look, I can actually rest. I'm sitting down with that shad right in the side of its mouth. That guy will go about 3.5 pounds. He's a real chunker. I love these bars. You know, when you think of smallmouth, to me they're like a freshwater tiger almost. And they're, when they're on the prowl, you know, one of the key things is to be out early before the sun gets too high, because then they'll shy off from going into that real shallow stuff. But I believe they do most of their feeding shallow when those bait fish move shallow, and then they move off into that deeper water and kind of get lethargic. You gotta use jigs and really work for them to get them. Finding fish attractive areas is one thing. The second challenge is figuring out what presentation and lures to use. Most of the time, I can identify the bait fish with my Raymarine unit, or I can visually see them in the water in shallow water. So I know what type of lure to use, whether to use more of a shad-shaped wide lure or a thinner lure that looks like minnows or bait fish. Then the challenge is to suspend that bait so that you won't get it caught in those isolated clumps or drag along the bottom. It's common, especially in the summertime, for the rocks to have algae on them. You definitely want to avoid bumping into those rocks with your hooks and catching that algae, because if you do, that'll take away the action of your lure, and that means cranking it in, taking the vegetation off so it's clean, and then casting out again. Oh, what a slam! I mean, I love it when they just smash that lure. Good sized bass. Trying to get him around the side of the boat because I didn't want him to get me in any of those rocks that are down there. A little closer. Maybe if I put the rod down, that'll help. Upside down. Now look at this. You can see he was just tagged on there with one of the hooks right there. This is where you need a whole bunch of pliers all around the boat so you're not scrambling to fight it. There, one more look, then we're gonna get him back in the water. Isn't that a good smallmouth? These things are so beautiful. Look, I'm gonna wait 1 sec, because that guy gave a noble fight, and there. Now, you know, I was talking earlier about using a long fluorocarbon leader. This one's about 5 feet long. When I make my connection, I actually use a blood knot. A lot of people use 2 uni knots, but I like the idea of having that low profile for the knot. And also this outfit, you know, it's a two-piece medium action, And I really like it. It's short. It's only about 6.5 feet long. I can still get good castability, and it's got enough flex so when that fish hits, I get a split second hesitation when I go to set the hook. So it makes sure that it has the hook in its mouth. Even though that guy tried to grab that bait fish by the back, it still got that hook in the upper lip and it wasn't gonna let go. I usually like to start early in the morning because I know the fish will be active and they'll be in the real shallow water, and usually the water's calmer then. When I do that, I start with a very lightweight lure that doesn't have a lot of action, just a nice side-to-side action that really imitates an injured bait fish or a shad. And I use the lightest line and fire that lure as close as I can to the shore and slowly work it back, trying to work it over boulders, other rocks that are on the bottom, and especially weeds. A lot of times these bass, you know, will follow really close behind that lure. You can actually see them because the water's pretty clear here. And then you gotta kind of work it, and you'll see that on the paws. I've actually seen them come up and nail it. Okay, see if I can flip this guy up. Never a good idea to just lift them with the rod, even if it's a smaller fish. Better to actually grab the leader if he's smaller. If he's bigger, obviously, you gotta, you know, go down and grab him by the lip or grab the lure or use a net. But there, he had both hooks in his mouth. Nice chunky little smallmouth. You know, I love this kind of fishing. I think now because the sun has come up a little bit, I'm actually gonna change my presentation and go to maybe either a soft plastic or an actual twitch bait, which is a good strategy. If I stop getting fish to hit on that faster stop and go presentation, I usually change to a soft plastic that I can fish extremely slow. And I try to pick a soft plastic that looks like a shad or a minnow, a swim bait. I try to avoid using the worms, especially if I'm in open water, because I'm trying to resemble the bait fish the game fish are feeding on. When I use the soft plastic shad, I normally don't add any weight to it. The density of the actual shad lets it sink slowly. What I do use is a very large worm hook, somewhere around a 6-odd or a 7-odd worm hook, and I make sure to bend the hook up a little bit so that it's a little bit open. And I rig a Texas rig so I can indeed go through any sparse vegetation and ride it over the rocks. I find that when I work that soft plastic bait fish off the bottom and work it towards the surface, that's when I get the most aggressive smashes.
What a nice hit.
You know, I've changed to a soft plastic, and it looks like a real big shad. And this guy came up and just nailed it. When you're fishing with soft plastics, these swim baits, you have to fish them a lot slower than some of the crank baits or even the twitch baits. I don't know if he's gonna get off if I lift him up. It's hooked really lightly, but I think I can pick it up if I'm really careful. Oh, look at this. Oh, look at. Good thing for big worm hooks. Look at that. This is the finesse shad. And looks like a big shad. You can see it's got a wide back, and it's got this nice split in the bottom where your hook fits in, and I'll show you how to rig in just a second, but there's a nice smallmouth. He came up and just smashed it. His reward is he gets to go back out there and smash some more bait fish. Nice, refreshing water. Look at, what a gorgeous green, almost bronze back. Watch, that water's clear. Look at him take off. Now, here's the way I rig this bait fish. I've got a pretty large hook. This is like a number 6 or 7-odd worm hook. So what you do is you just put your hook in, so about 1/8 of an inch through that finesse fish shad head, so that the hook you see takes on the profile of the actual bait. So now I figure out where I need to pierce it, which is right about somewhere there. And I open it up and I put it in there and it comes out the back. And there it is there. Now you can see the profile. This actually, you don't even see the hook. And that hook is pointing out a little bit. Now what I do, I'm gonna tell you a tip that I do. Normally when you get them, the worm hook will sit flat on the back. But because I'm fishing the shallow water, not really heavy weeds, just rocks and the odd weeds, I've actually taken, I'm gonna push that down, I've taken my hook with my pliers, held on to the bend of it, and I've opened it up a little bit. And I'll tell you how much. So when I put this flush to the back, you can see that the hook is sticking up just a little bit. See the way it's tacking on to my actual skin? So that's perfect for hook sets. It's angled up just a bit instead of being flat. If I was fishing heavy cover, I'd have it in the normal position, which is right along the back. But I really like the idea of having that sticky, sharp hook out on the edge like that. I'll tell you, they love that bait. That fish came up and just smashed it. No matter which presentation I use, whether it's a hard bait, like a twitch bait, or a shallow running crankbait, or a soft bait fish, rig Texas rig, I avoid using any terminal tackle. I use a fluorocarbon leader and tie the line directly to either the split ring, where I use a tight knot, or to the eye of the hook or the lure, where I use a loop knot, like a rappella knot. I want to maximize the swimming action. I don't want a tight knot to impede the swimming action of any of the lures that I use in shallow water. Did you hear that? That's like putting the pressure into the fish. I mean, this is a little bit different than using a crankbait or jerkbait because they hammer it when it's sitting motionless. This guy really grabbed it. Gorgeous smallmouth. You can see that big shad, he swallowed it. I don't mind kneeling for these fish. You know, when you're in this side of a boat, you gotta get a little bit closer. Because of that 15-pound or 12-pound leader, I should say, I can hold it up. You can see how well he's hooked. That's a perfect place to hook a fish. I love it when you can fool these guys in that shallow water, in areas where a lot of people don't fish because they actually don't have access to that shallow water, or there's big walls, you know. In this case, these guys probably haven't been disturbed and they come out of these very shallow areas and they feed very heavily. And that's where you can fool them with a soft plastic bait like that, or a shallow running crank bait or a twitch bait. This guy's brawly. Boy, he's got some weight to him. Don't get fooled by where that plastic grub is. This guy just nailed it. Oh, nice smallmouth. That fish hit so hard. I think he's almost ready. I'm actually gonna go down there. Hooked him really well. Oh, just below the eye. What a nice smallmouth. Now look where my bait is. That fish pulled it right up. Can you see me? Can you see me now? I'm not trying to hide. That bait got all twisted around, so I think I gotta actually change it now. Look at green, green, green. Sometimes they call them a green bass. Besides using my fish finder to locate key areas on these shallow flats, I also wear polarized glasses pretty well the whole time, and I look for things in the water. A lot of times, a little bit of a dark patch means a clump of weeds. Usually, a light-colored patch means one or more boulders. So it's very important to wear your sunglasses and look for those key areas, but don't get too close to them. You have to spot them in the distance so you don't spook any potential fish. Good one. Oh, good hit. Very interesting. You know, I was fishing and it was all kind of a flat bottom. Then all of a sudden I can see little tufts of grass. And surely this guy was right around the weed edge. Nice head shakes. Gonna get him a little closer. For a midday fish, I think adjusting that hook so that it's sticking out a little bit really makes a big difference. You can see he's got a nice fat belly. He's been feeding on a lot of real shad, not plastic ones. Okay, time to let him go again. Yeah, we got that beautiful sun. Look at how brilliant they look. In that green water, they blend right in. Gorgeous. Now, I've had good luck with this plastic shad, but you know what? I am going to go to a traditional bait, and I'll show you here. Actually, I've got them all lined up here, so I'm gonna tell you a little bit about them. These are them here. You can see they have one thing in common. This is the bait that I started off with today and did really well. You can see how much it flashes. That was the thin fin in shallow water. Now what I'm gonna do is use these guys right here. When I'm fishing shallow water and I'm searching for areas the fish are holding, whether I'm close to the shoreline like this in only 6 feet of water, or I'm out further on a flat, I use a combination of my chart, and this is the CMAPS chart that's extremely accurate. You can see here that it's showing 6-7 foot depth and then the really shallow stuff closer to shore. So I want to be able to cast to that shallow stuff and then bring it up here. But if you look on the right, we actually have the sonar screen. This is the down vision. You can see that here's the bottom, right along the bottom here, but look at the vegetation. It comes up to about 6 feet. So I'm slowly going to be inching my way in. Now it's 8 feet. Nice hit. We're going to call this a midday smash. Nice smallmouth. Come on, a little closer. I can see he was aggressive because he's got that front hook in his mouth. I love the coloration on him. You can see those nice modeling. I think they're beautiful. Okay, time for you to go back. Pretty fish. You have fun. You be careful what you grab, okay? If it's got sharp things on it, it's not so good for you. Nice smack, smash, that shallow water. Persistency really pays off and just, you know, keeping the same presentation. Come on, see if I can get him up in the boat. Good one. He threw that front hook. There, got that hook out. Gorgeous fish, that'll go about 17 and a half inches. Just lean. This guy hasn't been feeding like some of the other ones that we've caught, but they're all in very good shape. And there he goes. When I'm fishing these shallow water areas, our 1 or 2 foot change in depth, either shallower or deeper, can make all the difference in the world. So it's very important to fish all those little structure points and work them really well. If there's a fish there, it'll probably hit right away. I love to fish for smallmouth bass in shallow water because most of the time, there's no nibbling. They just smash the lure, the fight is on, and if you can get it to the boat, you usually land a pretty good-sized fish.
Canadian Sport Fishing has been brought to you in part by Rapala, premium fishing gear crafted from experience. Yamaha, conquer outdoors. Dickies, quality workwear since 1922. Northeastern Ontario, undeniably big, unbelievably close.
Every time I hook a fish, I got to make sure that that hook is in good condition. You know, eventually when using a soft plastic bait like this, you got to replace the bait. I make sure that it's hooked properly. The one thing that you want to do is make sure that that hook on the bottom is right along the center, not off to one side or the other, and then on top that it's also right along the center and exposed. That way you're going to get some really nice swimming action from side to side.